Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to present to you your hosts, Spencer and Lara Williams.
Hey everyone, I'm Spencer.
I'm Lara, and we're Married with Board Games. I recently became really excited about RPGs thanks to a little show on Geek & Sundry called Critical Role. It's introduced me to a new world of gaming that I'd really like to try one day.
Well, today is not that day. But we are going to take a look at a game that contains many of the elements that Lara appreciates in an RPG, and that game is called Diceborn Heroes.
Diceborn Heroes is a 1-4 player fantasy dice game that emulates a JRPG. That's Japanese role-playing game, if you didn't know.
Ah.
So, like most RPGs, players will control a party of heroes whose quests send them to far-off lands, facing monsters and protecting innocent bystanders.
Exactly. Now, a typical game consists of 3 quests and a boss monster. In addition to fighting monsters, players will also have the opportunity to buy items from the villages and level up their characters to add new classes and abilities.
Together, players will either defeat the boss and win, or get knocked out and fail the quest. Now, with this being a Kickstarter game, not all elements of gameplay and components are solidified. Having said that, let's take a look at what you might reasonably expect if you back this game.
This is how you will probably set up Diceborn Heroes. Well, you might have a variation on it, but this does the job. First thing I want to draw your attention to, and the thing you're probably going to want to decide on first, is which class you're going to be playing as. Now, starting out, you're going to have all level ones, of course, and you're going to have options such as the priest, and then there is the mage, and then you're going to have the thief, and then, of course, a fighter. Now, I want to draw your attention to some things on these cards. You've got the different abilities that they're going to be able to do after you roll your dice. And you can only, in most cases, only dedicate one die per round. So you can't put multiple dice down. You got to select which action you're going to do. So in this case, and you have to roll the number there to be able to put it down. So if I rolled a 6, I could do a body slam, which is going to do 3 damage. But then I would have to take a wound. Down here, you've got your health, so the fighter starts with 4 health. This is the color dice you're going to roll. Right here, you only see green, but you're going to see in a minute that you can have different colors. And, of course, you can only dedicate that color to the color that's on the card. So, in this case, you're fine because you've got a green die. And then there's a special ability that you've got this token that you're going to be able to spend. Reveal attack cards before assigning dice. That's a really good ability to use, but this token you can only spend once per quest, and so you really want to use that wisely. And then, as an example, you can see some of these other ones. Holy Light for the priest is going to heal any hero, or you can attack. Here's some more healing for the mage. You can see lightning. That's good. You can do an attack to 3 targets. And when you see a red, that's a passive ability. So what this means is if I dedicated a die to the mage right here, if I got attacked by an enemy, I would do retaliation, 1 damage to them. So that's really neat. And then there's a thief. Plunder is a good one. You attack and then draw an item from the item deck. So lots of variety in the abilities. But again, these are what you start with. So you're going to pick which one you want to play as. As we mentioned, you can play this game 1-4 players. Now, the game has to have at least 3 heroes in the game at a time, 3-4 heroes. Once you've selected your character, and then each one of your characters is going to get one of these tokens. That's what I was mentioning earlier about the special ability. This lets you know if you've used it or not. So everybody's going to get one of those. Each character will get 1 die based on the diamond that's in the corner. And then also each player will receive a green die. So if I were playing by myself, I would get 3 characters and then a single die for myself. That's just another additional die that you have to help you out. The next thing you're going to do is each character will get a special quest. You'll get 2 cards for each character and you'll be able to choose. So for instance, this says have at least 3 monsters alive, all with 2 wounds or more. If you complete that, you get you get to have that token back, and then you get an ability for completing that. So those are additional tasks for you to complete as well. After you get those, you can select your first quest. And you can see over here, these are our quest cards. And you start with one, you go on to two, and then you go on to three. You're gonna pick one from one at random. So in this case, we start with Goblin Raid. And normally what you do is you draw one monster from the monster deck that corresponds with the current level that you're at. So right now we're at one. And you draw one monster for each player. And then in this case, it says add Goblin Raider as an additional monster. So we'll be fighting four monsters in this case, plus Goblin Raider. And then it says if all enemies are defeated, gain the Astral Mirror, which is a special item. Different things on the cards are going to be, this is the amount of health that he has for you to defeat him. When he attacks, this is what he does, how he does damage. And then when he's defeated, you're going to be able to put two cards into the attack deck. And I'll show you why that's a good thing here in a second. What's neat about this is once you complete this one, you go on to the next quest in step two. Now, you don't pick one from the two deck at random. You look at this icon right here, and then you look through the phase, the quest number two deck, and look for that one. So we're going to go on to Murky Swamp. So we go from fighting goblins to a murky swamp. And you'll see some of the same elements on the card, except in this case, this is not a monster. This just has a special effect that you see there. And then the same thing, once you defeat this one, you're going to go on to three. You're going to look for that same symbol. And then after you defeat quest three, it tells you, well, this isn't the right one, but you get the idea. It'll also tell you to reveal the boss monster. And then you'll reveal a boss monster from this deck. And that said to reveal the Gaiamuyan. So we would look for this one. And then we would fight this one to finish our quest. I mentioned that during your quest, you're going to be revealing monsters. So in this case, since we're on the first step of the quest, we're going to reveal one monster for each player or for each character. So here will be a total of four. One, two, oops, that's upside down. Three, four. So we've got a shoe, a scorpion, a skeleton, and a vampire bat. Now, what you do from this point is you draw an attack card for each character, for each bad guy. And that's going to tell you what their speed is and when they attack. So in this case, we will do a plus four for Goblin Raider, plus three, and then so on and so forth. So each monster will get a number, and that tells you, you start at one, and then the higher you go, that's when the monster will attack. And then you compare what is on their number to the number that you have placed on your die to determine the timing on how everything works out. I won't get all into it now, but just know that that's basically how it works. Here's some more examples of some of the monsters, so you can get an idea of what you're going to be going up against. This again will tell you how many cards you get into the attack deck after you defeat it. Here's its health. This has a special effect. That means it will poison you. Here is an Aquamite. He's a mugging, stunning type character. This is a wolf. And then we've got Rackroot. So just some examples of some of the monsters you'll be fighting, at least level one monsters. There are a lot of monsters in this deck, including the ones down there. And again, there are a lot of monsters in deck two and deck three. Now, I keep referring to the attack cards. There's a deck that you set up at the beginning, and if you go through this attack deck, then whenever you have to reveal attack cards, for everyone that you cannot reveal, each player has to take a wound. So that's why it's a good thing when you defeat monsters, you put cards from the discard into the attack card deck. So you want to make sure you're constantly defeating monsters to keep that attack deck stocked. After you finish each quest, you'll go through what's called the town phase, where you can buy items. Some of the items you might buy are the red eye, so there's going to be a cost that you use. So however many monsters, a monster will have a level, a number, and that's what you use to spend. And so like this says, discard to gain a red die for the remainder of the quest. Solar Shade Dust, discard to kill a poisoned enemy. That's a powerful one. Healthy Potion, discard to remove three wounds from a hero, not stun or poison. So you get the idea, lots of options to choose from the items as well. After you buy items, you can upgrade your character. Now, on the back of your character card, you'll see that they have options. So this thief can upgrade to a monk or an archer. And then what you'll do is you'll look through the level 2 characters and find the ones you're looking for. So I'm gonna go with archer. And the choices you have are, you can either stay a thief and flip the archer card over and use one of the abilities. So I can add an ability to my thief, which will give me a new ability and an additional heart. Or I can go ahead and upgrade to the archer and take the thief card and add it on the back to give me an additional ability as well. So you have two options there in order to upgrade. And then also after the second quest, you'll be able to upgrade again. So lots of options when it comes to customizing your characters at the end of each quest. Finally, just some other little things. There are, of course, reference sheets that tell you what the different icons mean, and then also a turn order. And then these over here, they're ballads. If you upgrade to the bard, you have special ballad cards that you can use that give you special abilities. Heroes can spend a hero token to assign a second die. Heroes may reroll any ones on their hero die. So that's really cool if you upgrade to the bard. And then finally, you've got lots of different tokens. You've got wound tokens, you've got poison tokens, and then stun tokens, all for different situations. So with the disclaimer that, of course, this is not a final product, we do have some thoughts that we'd like to share with you. Obviously, you've come to find out what we think about it. Let's start with our first impressions of the game just based on what it looks like. So, artwork. What do you think about the artwork?
Super cartoony.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how exactly to describe it. It's not full on anime or manga or whatever that style is. So it's kind of like a gray area of that. It works.
I really like it. I really appreciate it. You know, I feel like it's kind of unique. You don't see it in a lot of games.
True.
So it is refreshing. I really like it. And kudos to the artist on this game.
Yeah.
And same goes for the graphic design, at least the way my opinion of it. Just the way that the cards look and all the graphics of the cards and how it all ties together. Do you agree?
Oh, yes, and the iconography and everything is, it's fairly clear.
Yeah, there's a lot of iconography in the game, but you know, there is a reference card for you to look at. And, you know, like you said, though, it makes sense of what the icons are.
So for the most part, you can figure it out.
And I think also with the game, sometimes you'll get components that you don't necessarily need or they don't really make sense, like, you know, additional cards or whatever. And I'll be honest, when I was first pulling things out, I was like, what is this for? But everything has a purpose. Mm-hmm. You don't get too much, you don't get too little. You get everything you need for the game. And I think it's perfect. So a perfect amount of game in this box. And speaking of game, let's talk about how the game itself plays.
Sure.
First off, I would say, and I think you'd agree with me, that this is a hard game.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, we haven't won. We've played several times. I've played solo games. We've played together.
Well, and especially, I did not read the rule book on this. You've always had us playing as two characters each. Is that standard?
So the way it works is, you know, if you're playing by yourself, you control three heroes. There's always at least three or four heroes in the game.
Okay.
So if you play by yourself, you control three. If you play with a second player, you each control two. If you play with three people, everybody controls one. And if you play with four people, everybody controls one.
Okay, got it. So with two players, each of us playing two heroes, we have not been able to beat this game.
Right. So that brings us to, you know, our first complaint, if you will, of the game is that it's unbalanced.
In our opinion, this is unbalanced, just in that, you know, we slog through a lot of this, and man, we just can't win for lose.
Right, and some of the solo games I played, I couldn't even get past the first quest. Now, having said all of that, though, before I even brought it up to the designer, he mentioned in an email that that is one of the things he's still working on. So the balance issues with the game is still a work in progress. So that was really good for me to know that it wasn't just a, oh yeah, you have problems with this? Yeah, we're working on that. No, that was, he brought that to our attention before us even mentioning it. Mm-hmm. So he is working on the balance issues. Having said that though, that it was difficult, I felt like the challenge was, it was fun though.
Right, I like how it's different. You know, normally when you roll attack die, you put sums together. Mm-hmm. But for this, you pick out just a couple.
Right.
And assign them to particular actions that your character can use.
It's
that.
Really cool.
That's and, really neat.
And it's tough decisions that you're making because you don't know what each monster is gonna have, the card that they're gonna have. Like they might have a special effect.
Yeah, you don't
effect.
Know what their attack is going to be.
You don't know what level their attack is going to be. So you
when
have to...
they will attack compared to yours.
Right.
And you have to really teamwork because there are some people who like there's the priest who just mainly heals and he does deal some attack. Or there are people who can mimic your attack so you're basically doing your attack twice.
Right.
And you have to communicate about that and say, you know, like, I think we should go this route and look at this guy. He has this kind of blah, blah, blah wounds. We should really try to target that. And here's how we can best do that. Like, it's really
cool. So it's not just rolling and seeing who has the higher number.
Not at all.
There's a lot of strategery.
There's strategery.
Strategery in how you place your dice.
Some decision making.
And which abilities are going to be used. And we really appreciated that. And, you know, you're rolling dice and you're drawing cards. So there is an element of randomness to it, you know,
yes,
based on, because the monsters could, in theory, draw all, you know, higher level cards and you could roll poorly.
They could all roll ones and knock you out before you ever get to do your attack.
Right. So there is some randomness to that, but I also feel like there are a lot of ways to mitigate that. So you have a special ability that you can only use once per quest.
Use it,
because we forgot.
The first time. I misunderstood and thought you only get it once. For the entire game. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking there might be a worse moment coming up.
Yeah.
We didn't even survive to that because you should have used them.
Yeah. So use that. You've got your items that you're going to gain between quests that'll really help you out.
Use them.
So it's not just...
It's a use it or lose it in this game. You know, there are some of those games that you rarely have to hoard them because then later you're going, I really need this right now. I didn't need it that bad earlier. No, in this game,
So I do appreciate that there is randomness, but you can mitigate the randomness too. One of the things that I really like about this game, and this is one of the things I find the most charming, is how you level up your character.
Between quests,
you can go up to another level. So like you can go from level 1 cleric to level 2 cleric, or you can... you know, kind
like
of morph into a class. Yes, change to a different class. And with that, you get to add additional abilities for you to choose from.
You can even gain extra life and extra dice
roll. Yes.
And what I like about it, though, is that it directs you from whatever you were before. Mm-hmm. On the back of that card, it gives you two options.
Yeah.
And you pick who you're going to be next. And I like that it's not just a willy-nilly, just go pick one. It's like, no, you have to go to one of these. And that's really neat.
Yeah. And so we kind of hinted at this, too, the cooperative nature of this game, that you really do have to work together. Planning on how you're going to play off of each other, how you're going to use your abilities in tandem. So we really like
who's
that aspect.
Who's attacking who?
Yeah. Yeah, it was a lot of good teamwork going on between us. And I really... Yeah. it is a good cooperative game. It's not just one person kind of conducting everything.
Unless you're playing a one-player game.
Well, yeah, there is that option. And also, I think there are two more things we want to hit on. One is it's very replayable, I think. You know, there are a lot of monsters that you're going to be drawing out at random.
Yes.
So, you know, from game to game, you still might not experience the same monster.
And you also may want to explore those different upgrades.
Yeah, exactly.
You may decide, you know what, next time
we'll go different
I want to go as a ninja.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of a time mage or
exactly.
whatever that was, you know.
Yeah.
Like, that'd be cool.
Yeah. And then also, you know, there are 8 different quests with 3 different steps each. So, you know, you've got all those different quests to explore, the different, you know, effects of those.
Yes.
And so we feel like there's a lot of replayability with this game.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally, the other, you know, complaint that we had was the rule book. But again, that's another thing that's a work in progress too. The first one was really hard to work from, and then we got a second one that was revised, and that helped out a lot. And so I have high hopes that the finished product is going to be a really good rule book, just mm-hmm. based on the progress that we've seen so far.
Yeah.
But I mean, do you have anything else to say?
Not really.
Yeah, pretty much. We pretty much covered it.
Yeah.
So, you know, the bottom line for this game is, if you're looking for a JRPG, but in a board game medium, you should definitely check out Diceborn Heroes.
While Diceborn Heroes is still a work in progress, we can honestly say there is a very fun and engaging game here. And based on what the designer has put together so far, we have confidence that the finished product will be high quality and an enjoyable experience overall.
So check out Diceborn Heroes when it goes live on Kickstarter on April 26th. It's a game that we think is definitely worth your attention.
We're going to box this one up for now. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to be alerted to more Kickstarter previews and follow us on social media. And for more reviews, blogs, and our podcast, visit marriedwithbg.com.